Hey, Adele. Hello to all our guests. Adele, are you hearing me?
I'm here. Valerie, your bandwidth is low, so you might want to either turn off your camera or go inside the house.
Adele, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay. Can you see me?
And you, no, oh, I cannot. I see your picture. Now I see you.
There we go. Okay.
Erev Tov, everybody.
Hey, everybody. Okay. Welcome to the future. Here we are, and we have our very special guest with us, Elliot Chodoff. And we're going to wait for a few more folks to come in. We've got some folks in the waiting room.
Thank you so much, Elliot, for agreeing to join us here.
My pleasure. I can only stay about 10 minutes. I don't know if Dave mentioned, I'm doing a webinar tonight at 10, my time, our time. But I'll give you a bit of a teaser and what I'll be doing. And Dave, you can get the link out to anybody who's interested.
The link is
Excellent.
already
On the
on
group.
the already the link is already on the page, and people can go
Okay.
down and register for the webinar, which is later on this evening, Israel time, mid-afternoon, Eastern Standard Time, at
Three more hours.
another 4 hours from now.
Three.
Right, three. This is why I don't do math. Okay. So, Elliot, thank you for joining us once again. And if you can give us your brief insights, I know you're doing show prep for your own program later on this evening. What are you seeing? What's going on with Hezbollah and with Iran? What's your take? Over to you.
Well, my take is that they are trying to push the limit. I am not convinced that Iran wants to get involved in a full-scale war right now, but I don't think they're going to that they will necessarily avoid it either. Okay, the nature of these things is that you get caught up in making short-term decisions rather than long-term, and I think they're in that mode. Our taking out both of Shukr and Hania the same night, and the two were coincidental. There was not a planned double hit. And anybody who's familiar with how these things work, they were set up completely separately. They presented themselves completely separately. It was, oh, we've got this guy and we've got this guy, and it's almost schizophrenic because the takeout of Shukr was sort of one branch of Israeli security and military. The taking out of Hania was Mossad and whoever else was involved in it. To coordinate two things like that in one night is beyond miraculous, and I find that impossible to believe. Having said that, Iran is now caught up in it. We've been beating up Hezbollah. They've been doing a lot of damage too. I don't want to make it sound like it's a one-sided thing. As a matter of fact, it's my belief that in relative terms, they're doing more damage to us than we're doing to them, but it's still painful. And they believe, and I think here's the key, I think they believe for a whole bunch of reasons that they're in a position to win. And part of that has to do with at least publicly wavering American support. And I say at least publicly because I'm not sure that American support is truly wavering, but it's looking that way in public. An Israeli approach over the last year, well, since October 7th, of basically absorbing what Hezbollah is throwing at us and not responding, that's read as weakness. And all of this sort of ties into the what they may see as a window of opportunity, and here it is. Now, a lot, I think, will depend on what type of retaliatory strike they launch and what its outcome is. And these are things that are imponderables. I don't do prophecy. My students and audiences know that I'm a disciple of two great political philosophers, Winston Churchill and Yogi Berra. both of whom said it's best to prophesy about things that have already happened. So I'm not going there. What I'm going to be doing tonight on my webinar is something a little bit different, although it's Hezbollah related, something I think very, very few people actually have covered. And that is, who are these guys? Who are the Shiites? Who are the Lebanese Shiites? Who are the Hezbollah Shiites? By the way, those are three different questions. What is their ideology? What is the Iranian connection? What does Khomeini have to do with all of this? And the answer is quite a lot. And Khamenei is as Khomeini's heir. And how does that bring us all to where we are today? And sort of dispelling some of the myths of the talking heads and the Western media, starting with the great Sunni Shiite divide, which is not as great as they make it out to be, that Shiites are a certain type. And the answer to that is no, they're not. There are some this way and some that way and some another way. That Hezbollah was organized as a response to the Israeli invasion of Lebanon in 1982. It was not, etc. So here, just a lot of background, because I'm a great believer in context, and understanding Hezbollah as a context helps us understand what's going on here today. And I'm also a great believer in Santayana's famous and often misquoted statement, "He who cannot remember the past is condemned to repeat it."
Two questions. And
knowing that, yes.
Sorry, two questions because I know time is brief. Go. Got your show prep.
Right.
You said Iran was hoping for victory. How would you define that victory on their terms?
For them, short-term victory is destruction or at least utter crippling of Israel. Long-term victory for them is imperial. They want to control first the Middle East and then the world. And they want to do it in Islamic terms. Here, subtle hint. The Iranian Navy is operating in the Gulf of Mexico. What the heck are they doing there? Okay. And last but not least in that answer, and again, I can't count the times that I have corrected commentators and interviewers, the IRGC is not the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps. It is the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps. And that should tell you everything you need to know about what they have in mind. In other words, this is, and I use my words carefully here, and I choose them carefully, the IRGC is to Iran what the SS was to Nazi Germany. It's the political arm to extend the ideology to the rest of the world.
That's pretty strong. Okay. Wow, it leaves me a little bit. Okay. Anybody got any quick questions before Major Chodoff has to move on? Anybody got any questions, please type them in right now, and we will pass them on to Elliot. He will be able to respond either in the conversation now, or he'll respond after, and I will backfill for those.
And okay. The webinar will be recorded. It's part of the launch, actually, of a podcast that I started a few weeks ago. I've got 5 or 6 episodes already up. But it was started on the basis of a famous statement by General Patton, and that is, the perfect is the enemy of the good. We didn't have it all together. It wasn't all organized, but, you know, kick it off and get it rolling and clean it up as you go. So we're in the end of the cleaning up stage as you go, and the webinar is really sort of the kickoff of it. But as I said, there are a number of episodes already up there and out there, and what I'll be doing with them, if for those who don't get to the webinar, is current events, which is what many of them are, a little bit deeper analysis, similar to what I just threw at you, but somewhat more extensively. By the way, the episodes are no more than 15 minutes each. If I have to do something for an hour, I'll do 4 episodes on it. So the idea is to do it, you know, in pulses. And the third thing that I'll be covering on it is sort of deeper general subjects, strategy, tactics, deterrence, methods, ideas. In other words, all the how can I put it, conflict and military issues that are often misrepresented and misquoted by the talking heads, once again, who know very little, if anything, on the subject, but they expound constantly on it, misusing terms and concepts. Here, you know, what is the difference between strategy and tactics, and how do you develop them? For example, I'm going to do a whole series on that.
Okay, very nice. IDF Reserve Major Elliot Chodoff, thank you for so much for being with us. I know you've got a
time. Thanks for having me.
Everybody, go look in the chat box. I put in the link to the webinar. Go to his website. It's going to be something very special, something to bookmark and follow, because, and Elliot's a friend. He lives a couple of hollers over if we were in Arkansas, right?
Right.
Because it's hilly around here. And
that's it.
I follow very closely everything he says and writes. And thank you for being with us once again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elliot. Good luck tonight.
My pleasure. Thanks.
What's developing now?
Yeah. What's developing now? It's like he said, he doesn't want to be a prophet until it's.
I don't do that. You know what? I'll tell you one other thing. There's another famous strategic quote that no plan survives first contact with the enemy. I say neither does any analysis.
Yeah. Oh, boy. Yeah. So many words. Thank you, Elliot. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
I don't know where I get them from, but I'm in a WhatsApp group that gets all of his short analysis, and I've been following him for a while, and I'm so impressed that you managed to get him on our
Group. We've chatted, and I've helped him get to reporters and vice versa in the past, and just to give a little background for those on the show, I wanted to get him up first without too much buildup. Elliot is from New York and went to Chicago to grad school. He's been in Israel since 1983. He's a population officer in the Home Front Command and also a tactical advisor for infantry units in the IDF. So that's pretty serious, and the man knows his stuff. Okay, so we're going to catch up a little bit. Adele is in Be'er Sheva, or are you back at home?
No, I'm in Be'er Sheva today.
Okay, Be'er Sheva today, and I am in our safe.
I was in Sderot today, mm-hmm. earlier, and the situation in Israel is so tense that I had to think twice. I mean, I'm doing work with the National Digital Center in Sderot. And I already, last week, I committed to going in this week on Sunday. And I get, like last night I went to bed and I'm thinking, okay, if the night passes quietly, then I'll go to Sderot. And even while I was there, I wasn't so sure I was doing the right thing. Like we plan our traveling around what's going to maybe happen. I'm supposed to be going to Kibbutz Yagur.
Up near Haifa?
Near Haifa, in order to interview, to record the witness of somebody from my kibbutz who had been kidnapped and does not want to record it with any media people. She only wants me to record it. And for our own posterity and for herself, and we've been trying to work this out for literally for months. So the last time that I was supposed to go up to her, the day before her son was announced as no longer being alive in Gaza. So of course we went to the Shiva instead of to record her. And then we said, okay, whenever you're feeling ready, whenever you're up to it, you let me know and I'll come with a friend because it's a long drive. And today, this morning, I was discussing with my friend, do we drive up to Haifa on Tuesday? Yeah. And it's just crazy that in our own land, we have to make all of these calculations and considerations. So,
well, we all know how tense it was here on Friday in the run-up to Shabbat, because everyone and his uncle and the media and the press also, they kind of fanned the flames, and I think unnecessarily, the hysteria. And everyone I see around me is not anywhere near as hysterical, nor at shopping, nor at businesses, nor on the roads, nor at my synagogue, nor people in our village. I'm not saying everything's hunky-dory. It's not, you know, but there's been no massive call-up. There's been no change in status from the home front command for civilians. No change. That could change in the next 30 seconds before the show ends. But at the moment, there is no change in those parameters. Okay, I want to make that clear. And although I'm recording here in our Fortress of Solitude safe room, I just put out a laundry. And actually on Friday, I wanted to film our table and our food that we made for Shabbat to show all of you and everybody who's going to be watching this after we post the show that take a deep breath, deep, slow breaths, so slow cleansing breaths. Yes, we are all tense. Yes, we're all aware of the gravity of the situation, seriously. But there's a difference between being concerned and doing something about it and just being traumatized and terrorized. That's part of the PSYOPs campaign that both Hezbollah and Iran are masters, 3D dimensional chess masters of PSYOPs. And unfortunately, much of the popular Israeli media, not all of it, falls into that sway, and it's like a dog chasing its tail. Who's going to get out the more hysterical, the hotter headline? Because you got to get those clicks. And that's the dark side of the media world. You all know this, I'm sure, from America and wherever else you are in the world. But to see it in real time and know, you know, you didn't have to write that. Now, what is happening is that they're getting an extra lift as well from the statements they're releasing publicly saying, oh, we may attack on Tisha B'Av, the 9th of Av, which is next Monday evening. In the Jewish world, as I put in a post earlier today, if you look down on the page, you'll see my post on it with a little bit of background for the non-Jews among us. It is the 9/11, the Pearl Harbor, the darkest hour, and everything in Jewish history, including the Holocaust and the first and second temples falling, rolled up into one. And the idea is psychologically to kick us in the gut, a real solar plexus hit to the Jewish world and Jews in Israel to get us off balance, terrified, and feeling guilty already. And it's, you know, this is next Monday and not even tomorrow, next Monday. And it's calibrated. It's, you can see it, how it's developing. They released a video showing rockets being put into place. They play a good game, but it doesn't, what matters is how we react to it. Are we going to preempt it? Are we going to preempt Hezbollah? That remains to be seen. Right now, the IDF and Prime Minister Netanyahu, the defense minister, are all meeting in a special session this evening for an update. As well, the CENTCOM chief of staff, General Michael Kurilla, is due in Israel tomorrow. And there is talk from the administration that Secretary of State Anthony Blinken may be coming to the region. Can't vouch for all that. That's just what's going around in the media. I don't have final announcements on that. When I do, I'll pass them on to everyone, and you'll probably hear it as well on your own. But at the moment, we are going on with our daily life. How do we plan? How does Adele know whether to go to Haifa or not? I'm supposed to go on Tuesday to a visit down to Be'eri and the Nova site. On Tuesday, our village is having a solidarity bus trip. So we'll be down there on Tuesday, and I'll probably live stream from there as well. So keep an eye open for that this coming Tuesday. But will that come off if things heat up before Tuesday? You know the emoji? That's where we are. Okay. All right. I asked everyone. Okay. And I'm going to unmute Yaakov if you have some comments on what Major Chodoff said, Everyone calls him in English Chodoff, but it's Chodoff. It's a chet. Anyway, Yaakov, you're live and rolling.
First of all, for people to understand, he mentioned the fact that the Iranians are active in the Caribbean area in South America. If anyone wants to know the history of the Hezbollah and the idea of the Iranians, you need to understand one thing. They were very heavily involved in the drug trafficking with the cartels in Mexico and in South America. I do not need to remind anyone here of the Iran-Contra affair. We had captured in 1978 and in 1982 tons of weapons, which were AK-47s, RPGs, and everything, and we had a whole bunch of this stuff. We were approached by Oliver North. We were told, hey, give us these weapons, and we will give them to the Sandinistas to fight the Contra affair, okay? Now, the people understand that Shiite Amal are a minority in the Middle East, okay? Now, they're a majority in Iran, but they're a minority in the area of Lebanon. And because of this, when the creation by the mandatory governments during the League of Nations made Lebanon, Lebanon, as you all know, was made into a Christian country. That's because the French wanted to control it, and they had it. Now, they move on further. The Shiite Amal were always the poorest of the poor. They were always let down. I will never forget my first meeting that I had with Nabi Berri in 1978, when I also met with a person who was known as Saad Haddad, who was commander of the South Lebanese Army. And I want to tell you something. This idea of what's been going on and everything, we can even go back further, of the participation of the PLO and of the Red Prince and of the idea of Munich and the whole thing, that this whole thing of an intelligence war, which has been fought, and which we're now experiencing with what happened in Iran. What happened in Iran? Let me get to this for a moment. The Iranian Republican Guard is divided among itself. They don't love each other. And there's a question here is, who puts explosives in the building where Hania was staying? Now, there was no great love for the Hamas, because a lot of people in Iran are very pissed off about the millions and millions of dollars going to give to the Hamas and to the Hezbollah, while people in Iran don't have basic goods and needs to pay for their bills. So there's a lot of animosity within Iran. Just watch the TV series Tehran, which is an excellent TV series, to know all about it.
Strongly recommend watching it. Yaakov, can I just interject one thing, just so folks know? Yaakov has lived in Maalot along the border for what, 30 years now, 50?
Since 1976. I came to Israel in 1974.
And he served in Lebanon when he said you met with Lebanese officials who served extensively in the IDF in Lebanon at the time in the first Lebanon War, correct?
I don't go by my ranks and ratings and everything, but I work very closely with certain people that I can't name, dealing with all this stuff. So I can tell you a lot of stuff here. There was a movie made recently, by the way, with, what's his name? The one, the actor that was in Maverick, what was it? The actor there? About the drug trafficking in South America, and I was very highly, when I saw the movie, it reminded me of how we had given these weapons to the Americans, to the CIA, basically.
Who is we? Who's the we that you're speaking about here?
I can't disclose.
No, you're talking about Israel, are you talking about Lebanon, you're talking about the U.S.?
Israel, outside of the on the road to Sidon, there were these major caverns, tunnels, you know, they're very good tunneling, that were built originally by the Waffen, by the Germans, for the Vichy French, and expanded by the Arabs, and it became storehouses with tons of weaponry. So when we came across this weaponry near Rosadia in these tunnels, what do you do with them? So we took them to Akko. A lot of them were transported by convoy after convoy, just going into to Akko to drop them off to be melted down. But we were approached by the United States, like I said, by certain people in the White House. You can see it all in that movie with Tom Cruise. It's a movie about it. Yeah, about the whole Contra thing, how they would fly down the equipment and everything, and about the drugs. Because you need to understand who pays the bills for Hezbollah in South America, who pays the bills here in Lebanon. All you need to do is go to the Bekaa Valley, and like I did, I went to the Bekaa 2 times, and I can tell you, fields upon fields of poppies, okay? Heroin fields growing there, and a lot of it is mixed with the Colombian and Mexican cartels. It's all going in. It's all being dealt with by somebody. I'm like, I won't go back in Southeast Asia when I remember some of the people of Air America, what we were doing there, but that was something else. Anyway, back to you.
Oh, okay. I just put in the movie, actually, in the wrong spot. I sent it to someone personally. Here, I'm going to put it right here. It's a movie called American Made with Tom Cruise from 2017. And as soon as I find out where I just posted the Internet Movie Database, copy this, right? And,
Let me just one second here. People are all wondering when the foot is going to drop and what's going to happen with the body.
The other shoe.
Okay. What's going on with Iran? First of all, they're in a real mess right now because of what happened with the assassination. Because there's a witch hunt going on. They're at each other's throats right now. They're trying to figure out who, what, when, where. There's also the problem with the Hezbollah in Lebanon, because what happened with Sakhar, they're trying to find out who told who and how did they get to him. So I want you to understand, we have a lot of friends who are still in Lebanon. People of the Falun Gong, people of the Christian Lebanese forces. There are a lot of people who are not happy with the situation with Hezbollah, and they're trying to figure out how they can stop the war and not be, because they're running shitless, because they know that if the shit hits the fan, what we need to do is to take out the infrastructure in Lebanon. But that's not going to stop the firing of thousands of rockets, of the Falak missile, like the one that hit the Majdalsams, that Iran-made rocket that hit Majdalsams. There are 800 vehicles. Okay, get this through your head for a moment. We know that there, I don't have connections to intelligence like I used to, but I know of at least 800 trucks with multiple launchers. There are 6 launchers per truck. Figure this out. 800 times 6, that's 4,800 rockets that can be fired all at the same time. Okay, there were, 20 second interval between each one. So if you figure, if they fire 4,800 Balak missiles at Israel, okay, look it up. Balak 2 missiles, they're, 50 kilograms of explosives per rocket. And if you figure out how many Iron Dome rockets we have available, and this whole thing that really pisses me off is about the United States right now, is that they're speaking out of the side of their mouth because they limited artillery shells, they limited the Tamir rockets, which are the Iron Dome rockets, which we are allowing to be made in Arkansas under allotment by us, okay? They're being made there. So they're trying to say, no, you can only have a certain amount. We need 50 caliber ammunition, we need 7.62. We used to manufacture all this ourselves until Kissinger sold Golda the golden cap. Anyway, back to you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for all that information, because that's things that I'm sure I would imagine most or all of you out there in video land are not seeing on your local media. And this is
there's a question here. Yakov, are you evacuated?
No, I'm sitting in my home in Mahalot. God forbid, I don't have a bomb shelter. I don't have a secure room. And let me tell you something. One of the first things that you learn as a combat veteran is that it was one of the things I was first told on arrival in a certain Southeast Asian country, was that if you consider yourself as dead already, you won't be scared. So I've been through 3 IEDs in Lebanon, several attacks in Lebanon, and to tell you the truth, if you fear death, then you'll be shitless, you know, scared all the time. But me, if it comes, it comes. That's how it is.
So, but most of the people where you live have evacuated.
No.
In Mahalot, no. Mahalot, despite it, I have 3-4 friends in Mahalot. Everybody's still there. There has not been a mass exodus from that city.
And have there been rockets there?
Oh,
yes,
well,
sitting around. Yakov can talk to that.
They haven't hit us directly. They have hit all around us. And it's nothing like sitting in your room and, you know, when the Vulcan or the Falak missile, which is a heavy explosive explosion, goes off right next to you because they are attacking, you know, Harmiron, Matat, Profes. And it's the strange thing that they're hitting a lot of Smia, Kisra, which are Druze villages, Porfesh, Bikin, they're hitting the Druze, and they don't understand. My Druze friends have said to me, let us go in, and there won't be one Hezbollah left tomorrow. These are guys, I'm telling you, these are guys that would go in, and like a certain, you know, the only way, okay, a good friend of mine once told me.
Time's getting tight, just...
I'll try and breathe. You're dealing with a primitive, barbaric people who, some of them are educated. They put on such a great show, but when you're dealing with some of these people, it is some of the worst. The only way to deal with them is to be more barbaric than they are. Okay?
That's a standpoint that is being argued about many times and has been in the past with the Druze fighters. On the other hand, just to be the devil's advocate, the Israeli government says we are the sole authority for using military force. We're not going to have falangot. We don't want to have falangot militias from Lebanon in Israel in IDF uniforms. So it's just, there is another side to that. But yeah, your best friend or your worst enemy, you get to choose. That's what it is with the Druze.
This is our biggest problem. We have, you know, I've talked to Arabs all over the place. I've been in Ramallah. I sat next to Itzhak Rabin. I've sat next to Ehud. And I've been with a lot of these people. And I've talked to them. The educated, and I'll never forget the famous statement by Amir Faisal. Those of the educated among us want you and know you. But you're dealing with leadership here and the people down here. The ones that committed the atrocity that murdered most of Adele's friends who are from Gaza, who you extended to them your assistance, you helped them and you did everything. And yet they came into your home, some of them, and murdered your own people. These were people that you helped. You took them to the hospitals in Israel, and you believed in them. But then they turned around, and they came to your home to kill you.
That's the...
There's a question here. What do you think should happen?
What do I think should happen? I think we need to... I'm trying to get this guy to shut up. I think that what needs to be done, what should be done, is that we need to sit down with these people. If they want to sit and if they want to have truce with us, and they want us to live. They have to come to the understanding. There's a whole thing of the Islamic religion that when you're dealing with the Arab land, and these are Arab lands, these are Umma'ari, they will not give up this until you become Dhimmi to them. But they need to understand they're not going to get their way. And to me, it's sorrowful that for so many years that we've tried to have peace. I never forget how many times I sat and we talked about, I'll never forget Issa Farbin, and how I almost came to tears with the fact of the betrayal of Yasser Arafat. I'll never forget how mad he was. Right before he was assassinated, I was supposed to be with him that night when he was assassinated. I'll never forget how many times he got pissed at Shimon and his poodle, Yossi Balin. The fact that you have to know who you're dealing with. And Arafat, you know, they said, shake his hand. And Rabin shook his hand on the White House lawn. But then we turned around, we had what happened in Jenin when we had the Muqattah, and we found it inside the Muqattah, all these documents of how he led the Intifada. You even have,
you know. I'm going to have to cut you off. We're almost out of time. We're simply running out of time, and it's a hard stop. It's not up to us. It's up to Zoom. Thank you for your commentary and your analysis.
Maybe we'll just have Yaakov as our guest and give him all the time he wants to talk, because he has so much information to share here. And before we finish, I want to give people a heads up that next week we're going to be having Manar, who used to live in Gaza. Thank God she is now in Northern America. And I spoke to her about an hour ago, and she will be happy to come on our Zoom
That's
next
really
week.
Really going to be unique.
And I'm putting a link here about an article that I wrote about her in Times of Israel in 2021, I believe. And so she's going to be our guest next week. And you will be able to get some very, very interesting insights on the Arab world. And as Yaakov was referring to, on Gazan mentality, because she lived through it, she survived it, and she's seen a lot. So
looking forward to that. So
thank you, Dave, for getting
thank you,
Elliot.
Everyone. Thank you to Elliot, Major Chodoff. Keep getting that wrong. Major Elliot Chodoff, to Yaakov, to everybody who's joined us here, and those who will be watching this when we put it up on page. And yes, Valerie, we do pray in many ways and in many styles. And, you know, it's a comfort. And I will say, every Friday night and Shabbat lunch for our the blessing over the wine is preceded by the 23rd Psalm. And when you read it, looking at the Galilee, and you read it, hearing the aircraft overhead, he sets a table for me in the presence of mine enemies. There's nothing more real than that.
Thank you for that, Dave. We're running out of time. I wish everybody safety for the coming days.
Take care.
Thank you all. Everybody for joining us.
Thank you all. Thank you all so much. Share this around.
Stay safe.